From Nashville's WSM Radio, the original home of the Grand Ole Opry, this is a Coffee, Country, and Cody podcast.
Hey, it's Charlie Matos, and in this episode of our Coffee, Country, and Cody podcast, Country Music Hall of Famer, Grand Ole Opry star Ronnie Milsap joins us on our studio hotline. Ronnie Milsap, the final Nashville show, an all-star tribute to Ronnie Milsap, Tuesday, October 3rd, 2023, at Bridgestone Arena. And I love how this interview starts, because you can tell how excited Ronnie is to visit with his longtime friend, Bill Cody. Enjoy our Coffee, Country, and Cody podcast.
Wild Bill, are you there? Wild Bill Cody.
What are you doing, baby?
Good. Just had some breakfast.
So what did Ronnie Milsap have for breakfast this morning?
I had pork rinds scrambled with eggs.
You can take them out of North Carolina, but you can't take the North Carolina out of them.
That's right. I'm a country boy.
I know you are. Well, thanks for joining me. I wanted to get caught up on something very significant in your life, career, and truly in the history of country music. And that is Ronnie Milsap has announced his final Nashville show, a star-studded tribute show featuring more than 30 artists, October the 3rd, Bridgestone Arena. And how did you arrive at this decision, buddy?
A lot of people, my manager, Bert Stein, told me about it, asked me, did I want to do it? I said, yeah, let's go. Like you said, there are going to be so many artists on this show that it's unbelievable. Well, I used to open for the Statler Brothers. There was a great show. We had the Statler Brothers with Tammy Wynette and then me.
Gosh, that would have been the first time you went out on tour, perhaps?
Yeah. That was a great show. Of course, I did the Charlie Pride show for years. Jack Johnson was my manager, and he said, Ronnie, we're going to have you do the Pride show. Jack Johnson was a good manager.
So what year did you get to town? You came here from Memphis. What year?
December the 26th, 1972.
How do you remember that date so specifically?
Because I remember I met the manager of the King of the Road Hotel, and he said, you're exactly what I'm looking for. How much do you make? And I told him, he upped it. How many nights you play? I said, 4 or 5. He said, 4. And he said, when can you start? I said, well, you want it soon? Yeah. I said, how about December the 26th? He said, that's perfect. So I had a job when I came here. I didn't want to have to sleep in somebody's garage or sleep in the car, all that. So I didn't have to.
And so the Ronnie Milsap story began. And the final Nashville stop is coming to Bridgestone Arena October 3rd. The lineup includes Kelly Clarkson, Little Big Town, Parker McCollum, Justin Moore, Scotty McCreary, Tracy Lawrence, Randy Houser, the newest member of the Grand Ole Opry family just announced, Sarah Evans, Lori Morgan, Neil McCoy, Breland, Phil Vassar, Terry Clark, the Band of Heathens, Charlie McCoy, and more. So that is the short list.
Oh, I love all of them. I worked with Little Big Town. They are a great group. Karen Fairchild and that whole group is so good. I played the Jimmy Fallon show in New York with them. Lost in the 50s tonight, and Jimmy Fallon came out and sang with us.
He loves it, man. He can't get enough of it, that's for sure. When did Jerry Bradley sign you? You talked about being signed to King of the Road. So how long did that continue before you had interest from RCA and signed your label deal?
I wasn't working on Mondays usually, and Jack Johnson said, we're going to Jack Clement's studio and make a tape, sign tape to Jerry Bradley. So all those early records that I had are basically demos. That Girl Who Waits on Tables, a demo. And I Hate You, a song I'd fought for ever since I tried to get into music. I fought for that song written by Dan Penn from Memphis. And Dan Penn pr- produced an album on me for Warner Brothers.
So you had a friendship, a working relationship with him in Memphis before you got to Nashville and you knew about the song?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He had the waltz and I changed it. And I remember on the session, I was asking Charlie McCoy, I said, Charlie, what are you going to play on this song? He said, I think I'm going to play organ. And just to test him a little bit, I said, what's the last big hit you played organ on? He said, Easy Lovin'. Got my attention.
A song of the year. And a single of the year.
Oh, boy.
So were you talking about those demos that would actually become records? At what point does Jerry sit you down, listen to your stuff? And I know a bit of the backstory on that conversation, which I would love for you to share with the audience, but how does that deal go down when you actually put pen to paper?
Jack took the tape to Jerry Bradley, and he said, this tape by Ronnie Milsap, I'm managing him. And Jerry said, yeah, we know about Milsap. He plays in Memphis, and he's rock and roll, and he's rhythm and blues. He's a country. Then Jack played him That Girl Who Waits on Tables, and he said, well, that SOB can sing country.
And so began a Grand Ole Opry membership and Country Music Hall of Fame run for Ronnie Milsap. 40 number ones would follow, 6 Grammys, CMA Entertainer of the Year, 4 times you've won Album of the Year, on and on the list of accolades. Mike Reed speaks specifically to our friend, mutual friend, and songwriter Hall of Famer Mike Reed, and where you are introduced to his songs and how you came to cut so many of them.
He had heard my version of Misery Loves Company. He heard my version of that. Mike Reed told Rob Galbraith, my producer, he said, I want to go over there where they do that. So I started cutting about everything Mike wrote. I remember being in my studio downtown at Ground Star at 4 in the morning, working on a mix with Les Ladd, my engineer friend, and he said, damn it, Millsap, if you just stop, let me have a cigarette, I'll get this mix done for you. I had quit smoking for 18 years, and I went right back into it. I said, what are you smoking? But I kind of like to smoke. I'd smoke chains if I could light them.
All right, so let's go back. You talked those early hits, the demos and all that stuff. The game changer for Ronnie Milsap was a song called Pure Love. Eddie Rabbit.
That's right.
And how'd you get it?
I was over at Tom Collins' office, and he said, I met this guy last night named Eddie Rabbit. He's got a song called Pure Love. You want to hear it? I said, yeah. So we listened to it, and I said, all right, let's do a chorus, a verse, an instrumental section, and the chorus again, and there's the record. You make it sound too easy, Ronnie. Well, it is easy. We just go in and do that. I remember cutting that song on January the 8th, 1974.
Pure love, baby, it's pure love. Milk and honey and Captain Crunch and you in the morning. Baby, it's pure love, 99 and 44, 100%.
So what is the biggest song in Ronnie Milsap's career? Is it What a Difference You've Made in My Life?
Well, that's certainly one of them. Wow, Bill, it sure is. I think when I got to the song called Almost Like a Song, Joycey and I had been listening to that song. We were out on the road and I was playing that tape that Tom Collins had given me. And Archie was not a great singer, but the song was excellent. He kept saying, why do you want to listen to that thing? It sounds awful. I got back here with my piano in my living room, and I worked up an arrangement, and she came in and said, well, what is that? I said, that's that song you've been hating all year. She called Tom Collins and said, see, you've got to come over and hear this. So Tom came over and I played it for him, the arrangement I had, which you got to go up and hit that last note. You got to be right on it. It's a high A flat. Call Archie Jordan and said, damn, Archie, you're about to have your first number one record. And it sure was. I was so happy about that.
And it was almost like a song. And what a difference you have made in all our lives. Those who know you and love you and your late wife, Joyce, how special she was to those of us who knew her well. Again, thank you for your time and the great stories and memories. And the final Nashville show is a tribute to Ronnie Milsap. It's October 3rd, Bridgestone Arena. Just a couple of days shy of WSM's 98th birthday on October the 5th. Ronnie, how about that?
Boy, that's great.
And the guest lineup, it's Kelly Clarkson, Little Big Town, Parker McCollum, Justin Moore, Scotty McCreary, Tracy Lawrence, Randy Houser, Sarah Evans. And speaking of birthday weekend, right around that same time, Sarah Evans on birthday weekend will become the newest member of the Grand Ole Opry, followed on the 24th of October by John Party, Lori Morgan, Neil McCoy, Breland, Phil Vassar, Terry Clark, the Band of Heathens, your old pal Charlie McCoy, and so many more, honoring you and your 50-plus year career, your celebrated catalog, and your forever lasting influence on country music. Thank you for joining me.
Hey, I love you. I would come and do the show with Bill Cody anytime, anywhere.
Well, thank you.
Because I love you, man, and you are the best.
You're very kind, and I thank you for your time. And
I know it. So does everybody listening. They all know you're the best.
You're sweet to say that, and I treasure your friendship through the years. And again, Ronnie Milsap, I love you, and the world loves you, and we celebrate you on October the 3rd. Congratulations, pal.
God bless you, Bill Cody.
Once in every life, someone comes along, and you came to me. It was almost like a song.
Thanks for listening to the Coffee, Country, and Cody podcast. Make sure to subscribe so you never miss an episode. And please leave us a 5-star review. This podcast was produced through the facilities of WSM Radio in Nashville, Tennessee. The hosts of Coffee, Country, and Cody are Bill Cody, Charlie Mattos, and Kelly Sutton. Producer, Eric Markham. WSM General Manager and Director of Content and Programming, J. Patrick Tittle. Copyright 2023, Opry Entertainment Group Holdings, LLC.